is how to disrupt the insurance processes and provide a better customer experience using AI and machine learning. So to cover the topic, first, we will present a kind of history of the traditional way of building insurance platform and how this approach has, I would say, impacted the way that today we make the business, or even provided some limitation of how we make the business. The second point is to present the impact and the new opportunities that AI and machine learning can provide to disrupt and to change our business as a financial service or insurance company. We will also present the topic of ecosystem. And finally, how ecosystem, AI, machine learning contribute to change our processes, change the way that we make our business, so disrupt our business and open up to new opportunities. And we will use a concrete example on the claim. And we will finish by a Q&A. So let's start first by presenting the first approach of a kind of history, how the traditional way of building platform has impacted, I would say, or has led to some limitation in the way that we operate our business until now. Just to explain a bit, and sorry if I come back to topics about IT and architecture, but it's always the foundation, is that the past 10 or 20 years, the strategy for financial service company on their way that we operate was to implement, to set up platform, insurance platform or banking platform to provide capabilities for our business or to provide a way to operate their business in terms of processes, workflow, rules engine. And the strategy was mainly the past 10, 20 years to define what could be the best pattern of implementing such platform. So we had the pattern of looking for coordination, which means we have different type of platform sharing the same data model. We have the pattern of replication. So we have a platform and we copy paste, I would say, this platform in the different countries or entities or even line of business. The worst pattern was diversification, which means, okay, every country, every branches, they have their own platform. But the Graal, the best target was to mainly look for unification, which means we have a platform and we try as much as possible to centralize processes, to centralize this platform and to unify all the different entities, countries using the same platform. And that's the target in order to be efficient and to scale efficiently such a platform in the different countries or even line of business. So even trying sometime, if we have a good platform from PNC, why not to leverage the same platform covering other line of business? So that was, I would say, a more traditional way of implementing capabilities. But the question, we are talking about data analytics. Why starting by this introduction? What was the impact of having this strategy of implementing building blocks or trying to unify building blocks in the different for the different entities or different countries or line of businesses? The lesson learned of that strategy was first, yes, it was efficient for scaling. It's true. It was efficient for scaling, trying to leverage ERP or core insurance platform. Yes, it was efficient. But the drawback of that was one size doesn't fit all. It's not because one platform works very well in France or in UK that it works very well in Latin America. We also realized that this approach was not providing the full modularity because the way that we operate the business in one country is not really the same that we operate the business, and the market is not really the same in another country. And those platforms was not able to propose the full modularity or flexibility that we need, especially when we are when we have some emerging countries that we have to tackle, to manage. It was also complex to manage this common and shared platform. And that's why even some of you are familiar with the concept of a center of expertise or a central team. And we realized that this approach was not the most efficient or even the less expensive one. Another drawback was also being provider dependent. So when we select a provider, so you take the, I have in mind, for instance, SAP or other type of provider, Oracle and so on, sometime, but we realize that after we are close with this provider, and if the provider doesn't include in the roadmap the expected functionality, I would say we are blocked in the capability that we can provide. And at the end, and that's why I decided to start my presentation by this topic, this approach that has been in place since the past 10, 20 years, we realized that was not enough agile, flexible to innovate at the pace that the market expects us to innovate. And if I take example in the insurance business, the past 5 years, we have seen new insurtech coming in the market, such as Lemonade, for instance, or even other insurtech. And we have realized that those insurtech, they are not using such a big platform. They are coming with new technology stack, new capabilities, and they are disrupting the market because they are more flexible, they are more
Joel,
the way that they use those traditional platforms. Yes.
Yeah, the line dropped just to make sure internet is fine. Thank you.
Is it okay? Could you hear me?
Now it's okay, yes.
Okay, perfect, sorry. So yes, we realized that it was, I would say, a roadblock in the way that we can innovate in the market. So that's a kind of a little bit of history of being difficult the past few years sometimes to innovate in our market. I'm not talking about providing the right services for the customer. I'm more talking about agility and flexibility and innovation that we can provide for our customer. So that is the history. But open up new opportunities for all the financial service company to innovate is AI and machine learning. Why? So
Joel,
AI
sorry,
and machine
Joel,
learning
sorry, sorry,
is definitely a key impact in the priority for the financial. In terms of opportunity to provide value to our customer, definitely AI, data and analytics, is now a key priority for the financial service company. For instance, today, now it's a no-brainer to have at least a chief data officer in all the financial service company. Big data analytics platform is now becoming, I would say, a key priority or a key element in the budget of the strategy of the CIO. So it's now I would say obvious that we have to invest on that and to continue to invest on that. And even Gartner highlights by 2025, AI, video, audio, text, emotion will trigger major innovation and transformation in 75% of Fortune 500 companies, which means that until now, we have tapped a lot on structured data. We have used a lot of structured data, and more innovation will come from unstructured data. So I would say that now analytics, AI, machine learning is becoming a no-brainer in terms of investment and priority for financial service companies. In terms even of platform and architecture, we have seen evolution also the past few years. We have started to use first data warehouse using such a platform for financial reporting, for regulatory reporting, for analysis, for risk analysis. And we have after moved from this data warehouse that was the foundation of the traditional BI, moving more and more toward classic big data, which is the 5 years ago, starting by building a first data lake, mainly for marketing, for actuarial analysis, starting customer insight. After moving to in-memory processing, leveraging some data visualization solution that can perform analysis in memory. And now, we have also to manage real-time analytics, streaming data, and to provide also real-time capabilities. And even what we expect more and more from our platform, it's to be on this Lambda architecture, which means I can manage both classical batch, but also I can manage also real-time data using the same platform. For the sound, is it better, Mucine? Could you hear me well?
Yes, yes.
Okay, perfect. So with that change that came the past few years regarding leveraging AI machine learning in our business, we can highlight that today this approach has so different level of that can provide a different level of value for us. So we have, I would say, the foundational capabilities that can be provided by data and analytics. The foundational capability is at least to collect data, to provide basic reporting, and so provide, I would say, the basic capability for taking decision. After, we have the descriptive analytics. The descriptive analytics provide capability for interactive dashboard, even real-time dashboard. We can do benchmark. We can even help us to get the KPIs that we need for taking some decision. We have a centralized data repository. And from that, the past five years, we have invested moving toward predictive. So using, I would say, the historical data, we are now able to have some predictive models to use, I would say, classification, to use regression, to get some prediction of what could be the potential sales target, particular segment, or even to use customer retention, customer churn for cross-sell or risk analysis. those three levels, foundation, descriptive, predictive, definitely they augment our business. Those capabilities make us better. We are more efficient. We are able to, for instance, for the customer to be more proactive in the way that we can provide services to our customer or interact with our customer. So those three levels, they augment our business. But now, if we go to the cognitive, it changes the way that we operate our business. Because when now we are starting to work about natural language processing, chatbots, decision automation, even if I take the example of image processing, it's now transforming the way that we operate the business. Let's take a concrete example. If I take the case of a claim, you have a claim. The past few years, when you had a claim, you had to contact our call center, the agent, to notify the claim, to fill in the form to explain what happened with the claim. You had after all the processes managed, and to come back to my introduction, with the traditional platform that was used to process the claim, to evaluate responsibilities, to make a damage assessment, and finally, process the payment or the settlement of the claim. So that was the traditional way. Now, and if I take the case of InsurTech like Lemonade, you have now capability to provide using cognitive AI instant settlement, which means that you have a claim, you are paid the minutes after that you notify the claim. So everything can be processed, I would say, automatically, or you take the picture of your damage, and the damages can be evaluated by an AI system. I'm not talking about all the claim, but especially for low value claim. So now, using those capabilities, we are not augmenting our business, we are transforming our business. We are able to change the way that we interact with our customer. We can provide new type of services for our customer. And exactly, it was the same type of disruption that the GAFA has provided the past few years as well. They are transforming the way that we interact with our customer through those AI capabilities. And that's the point, if I come back to the insurance business, that now AI and machine learning, they are no more augmenting our business, they are transforming the business. If I take the case for each type of product, line of business, on the motor, now we are no more talking about you have a car, you are insured with the damage that you can have with your car, but now more and more we can also take into account the behavior using telematics, the behavior that you have when you drive your car, or even we have to take into account now that the new generation, they are also thinking more mobility rather than a car itself. So it's the way that to think insurance, not only for the usage of a car, but more as a mobility. The same for home, that now we can also think smart home. So it's also the way for us to change the paradigm, not being only a payer when our customers are facing a claim, but becoming a partner. So it's moving from payer to partner, which means we provide services to our customer leveraging AI capabilities, and to provide, for instance, personalized advice or service. The most promising capability or topic is definitely on healthcare, because healthcare, we have a huge opportunity to change the way that we provide services to our customer, leveraging AI machine learning, on being more preventive, being participative to telehealth, to think about population health management, so to include well-being, chronic disease, to be more, I would say, as a service, even for the medicine, being having in mind the personalized service, thinking more ecosystem, because by the way, what our customer have in mind is not only a surgery, but is more the full service that can be provided to them. Even for life business, we have also a new way to change the relationship with our customer, thinking about, for instance, crowdfunding or affinity investment. So just for you, through this slide to explain that AI is now disrupting our business, because we are no more relying only on the scope of provided by the traditional core platform, policy admin system, claim admin system. Now the scope of data is broader than only what we can capture when our customers subscribe to a policy. And AI and machine learning provide new way to transform or rethink the set of services that we can propose to our customer. Just to continue on this topic, we have in this slide, I have highlighted the main step of the insurance value chain. So we have the attract, engage, acquire, relationship, support customer, grow, retain. And even I think this value chain can be applied to other type of business. Can be applied for financial service, but even broader. For this value chain, I have highlighted when we consider capabilities that I have presented before, such as descriptive analytics or even predictive analytics, we have the type of use case that we can implement or we can build using descriptive or predictive analytics. We can have definitely BI, new pricing approach, simplify underwriting, fraud detection, and for the one that are working in the financial service is a key topic. In the past 5 years, using machine learning, it has provided a new way to better identify fraud patterns, better also identify segments, analyze weak signal. So definitely descriptive and predictive analytics bring a lot of opportunities. But now, if we go into cognitive, which is artificial intelligence, and is the bottom part of the slide, it definitely opens new domains, new area of business. So using AI, we can more include now innovative products that even in the past was not possible to think. If I take the case of health, it was the point of my previous slide, we can think now about being more preventive using the data that we can have from the claim. We can even provide some advice for well-being to our customer. On the contact center, we are realizing that now we can definitely transform the interaction with our customer, leveraging AI. We can even change the way that we operate some processes with process automation. Maybe for some of you, you remember all the approach on Lean Six Sigma. I think today AI and natural language processing, for instance, for document processing, brings opportunity to really automate a large part of the process using this type of algorithm, and we can open new type of services. So AI especially and cognitive services are definitely a way to disrupt our business. And coming back to this architecture view, how...
Well, just 1 minute. Sorry, Joel, just 1 minute, if you can be so kind just to summarize it.
Okay, perfect. So today, how it can definitely change the way that we provide business, that we provide capabilities for our business, is today to have more an hybrid architecture with the traditional platform that still are part of our landscape and are making their job to make our business, but also use in the different part of our architecture those AI capabilities. So that's why even now more and more Gartner has shown that we are now talking about composable architecture, which is a composition of AI capabilities and IT capabilities that live together as an ecosystem. And that's all.
Thanks a lot. Thank you so much for the presentation. It was really interesting. We have questions. So we start with the first question, Joel. Jose Matias is asking the question, great industry transformation. Thank you for bringing your experience. Could you please build on your experience of who drives the AI and analytics innovation in the company, the top management or the relevant departments like claims?
Okay.
Who then get the support from the above?
Okay. So to answer this question, so today now the innovation is driven by the top management now. But being honest, and it's also linked to this presentation, in order to be on the situation that today is driven that is the fact that in the past it was not really the case. So in the past it was more, I would say, first the CIO, after the CDO, the chief data officer. When the chief data officer has shown some concrete result through analytics use case, it became more and more the head of department of the business taking care of that. And now I would say the top management is realizing that AI, data and AI is now the new way to make business. So that's why the fact that AI open new type of product, new type of services, new type of businesses, it's now more and more the top management that is now taking the ownership of the topic, leading the topic with the contribution of all the company. But I would say now AI is no more something that has become only on a lab or limited to one department. Is really becoming a new way of making business.